Good morning and welcome to WEP On Air. My name is Michelle Ponto. I am the Senior Communications Advisor here at KAUS, and I'm here today with Estelle Metayer. She is an entrepreneur, trend spotter, and conducts workshops on future trends and industry disruption. Welcome to WEP On Air.
Thank you.
So we've heard a lot about digital disruption, but your specialty is industry disruption, which sounds a lot bigger and exciting and a little bit scary at the same time. So tell me about some of the disruption that you're already seeing.
There's a lot of signs and early signs of disruption that we don't always anticipate, and we don't really know where, how far it's going. Let me give you an example. Last month in the US, two computers started talking to each other. We all know about artificial intelligence. What we don't know, those two computers spoke in a language that was their own language, and it was the first time scientists could not decode the language. So the implications of technologies are getting stronger. Another example, autonomous vehicles. We all know that autonomous trucks and cars will be roaming our streets in the next few years. What we don't understand is the impact it will have on retail. For example, when people can be dropped off in front of a retail, what does it mean for the retail store? Cities will have to design our buildings differently. We'll have to have a curve where those cars can stop and drop off passengers. We'll have to completely rethink the entire environment around it. We don't anticipate it. The Olympics, for the first time, Paralympics. I know you're an athlete. So Paralympic athletes had better performances than other athletes. What does it mean in terms of human enhancements and what it will mean to be human in the future? Blockchain right now, we're talking about the explosion of consortia and groups of people working on blockchain, yet we don't really grasp, the public doesn't really grasp yet how many industries will be impacted by some of those. So what I find is there's a lot of signs of disruption, but it's very hard right now for companies to dissect what it will mean for their industries. And the consequences can be really enormous.
You work with CEOs on this kind of change. What do you suggest, though, especially when you see big changes like this happening? Because some of the changes you're talking about almost seem like we need to restructure our entire cities. We need to almost start from scratch because things are changing so rapidly. How can people evolve but still stay profitable?
I love your expression, starting from scratch, because that's the issue, right? In the past, we recruited people into our companies who knew the industry, were experts, had 35 years of experience in energy, in aerospace and else. And what we're finding now is because disruption is coming from the periphery, companies and CEOs need to surround themselves with people who come from completely different fields. A retailer should be looking at someone who's been working on fintech to understand what influences some of those blockchain technologies will have. Somebody in energy needs to hire someone from Airbnb because they need to understand how shared services will be structured in the future. So what's really hard for CEOs, and I work with CEOs and boards in particular, is we always have people who have a huge amount of expertise in a specific field, and we should change that. We should really think about getting people who have a different expertise and bring it in. And our internal biases when recruiting, all the HR departments in companies right now are starting to think about who shall we recruit who thinks differently than what typically we have. In fact, I've heard last month about a company which dedicates 20% of hiring practices to hiring great people, but with there's no job. But they will create the jobs to be able to integrate those minds into the companies. That's very rare still. But I think that we're going to see more and more of that.
That is really interesting that you hire the great minds and then create the work around that. When you were talking, I'm thinking this is going to be hard for people because even myself, when I'm looking at my own personal social networks and the kind of conferences I go to, it's all people like me who are doing the exact same thing over and over. I don't know anybody who is doing something completely different. How do you expect these CEOs to and industry leaders to find these great minds that are way outside of their realm?
It's interesting because it's a paradox. We never had at the tip of our fingers as much access to people all over the world in different fields than before with social media, for example. So there's a few things that we've seen. We've seen the explosion of TED. And I think CEOs started loving TED because they would actually be seeing videos of people who come from different fields of interest. And that was a great start. But I would say going to conferences that are completely outside of the realm of what you're doing. So you're in academia and science, you know, when is the last time you went to a doctor's conference? Because if you listen to doctors, you'll understand where science needs to go. Have you been to Burning Man? We are seeing a lot of those new funky conferences with no agendas, but just the right people in the same place as a place where you go and you get some ideas. And I also think you need to force yourself to branch out into new networks. I know I'm a huge user of Twitter. Every month I will branch into an area I don't know about. So a few months ago I heard about how rappers would be a place where rappers and musicians pick up on very early signals. So I started following a lot of them on Twitter. Eventually you figure out which ones are the ones you want to continue following, but you need to branch to those places. Architects, designers, food scientists, chefs. These are all areas which are not necessarily your network, but it's useful to go and branch out.
This is really interesting because technology does need to change in how we think, because right now we're very into keywords. You mentioned Twitter and hashtags are a big deal. So even I know with human resources or when I'm looking for a topic, I use keywords that I know, where you're suggesting we need to start using keywords that are outside of our normal scope. So it's
very interesting. Well, we're talking a lot right now about the filter bubble. How by using the same keywords, you necessarily will end up in the networks of people who use the same keywords as you. And I love the analogy. So you have to change from keywords to people. So you have to eventually follow the interesting minds, and you'll have to watch what keywords they're using and which new keywords they're using. So you have to let go of your assumptions and really look at other things that we naturally filter out, and we have to stop that filtering out, because I think we miss a lot of risks but also opportunities if you do that.
That's really great advice for especially our students here, because a lot of them I know they are following other professors and other areas that are just in their niche research area, but you say they need to expand, especially for future jobs. What kind of industries are opening up for researchers that are beyond their normal scope?
There are so many places that are opening up. I was thinking science and technology is so much at the core of every industry today, more than ever before. You know, the same way electricity is has been powering our industries. The same way our industries have been, electricity has been powering a lot of industries, internet has been powering a lot of the way we have our internal processes now. Science and technology will be everywhere. I was reflecting the other day, a video came out of an Amazon warehouse with robots everywhere, but not just the robots, the algorithm that's actually articulating how people pick up the items before they ship them to clients. Retail has become an algorithm industry. It used to be about display, about assortment, and this has all changed. We're talking about energy. When we start producing energy in our own homes and trading it with our neighbors, the house next door, you know, who's going to articulate the algorithms behind that and the technology behind that? Robots and drones, you do a lot of robotics here. The statistics came out that in Japan right now, the robotic density, which is how many robots per worker, has gone up to 1,500 robots per 10,000 workers, but that never has been done before. So this is growing fast, and we'll have to understand, is there a labor law for robots, what happens with their robots' rights, how do we articulate our relation with robots. So I think scientists will have to worry about questions of philosophy, will have to worry about the legal implications of their technology, will be anthropologists, how are people using those machines we're designing, what is the relation we're starting to have with machines. And I would think if I had an advice for your students, I would almost have two majors. I'd have a scientific major and I have a humanistic major, whether it's philosophy, psychology, anthropology, design. And I think if you have those two, you will never be out of a job because companies are going to be starving for those skills.
There, you mentioned everything sounds very futuristic when you're talking, but at the same time you mentioned that rather than looking at keywords, we need to start looking more at people and connecting differently, which is almost a step backwards from where we've been going, developing these more interpersonal skills.
Yeah.
Is this something you're seeing also as a trend?
Yes, very strongly. Well, every trend has a counter-trend. So I think the trend, you know, what goes against full and 24-hour connectivity and access everywhere and big data is the counter-trend where people go back to meaning and purpose and values. If you ask your students who they would want to be working with, they will mention an industry, they'll mention a purpose. They want to do a company that has an impact on the world, whatever, whether the impact is scientific or human or development. And many, many people go back to that purpose. You know, we hear about mindfulness, I think one of those big trends. I was watching the other day, media is completely changing. Snapchat and Instagram means we consume media in very small chunks, yet in Norway there's a new TV channel that just started that has 4-hour long shows of showing a train going through Norway. You start watching the show, it's on YouTube, you can actually check it, and I'm sure your tweets should be finding that link. There's a camera on a train and for 4 hours you just watch the train going through the snowy fields of Norway. Why would people do that when they're connected on their iPhone all times? Because we need that. And I was reflecting on robots and machines and thinking the real question behind robot is not whether they will take jobs away, because we all know every revolution took jobs in one field and created some elsewhere. It's really what are we going to be doing and wanting to do once those robots take off the jobs? What will be our purpose as humans? I think that we'll get very quickly to those questions.
And that leads me to my next question, is fear and change, because it is happening quickly and it's going to happen. There's no stopping it. When you're working with CEOs and or anybody, even in any industry, and this change is happening, how do you help them accept that it's going to happen and deal with the fear? And especially as a CEO, you have your own issues to deal with, but then you have a team beneath you that is also afraid that they're going to lose their jobs and that they won't be able to keep up. What kind of advice do you give?
First, you have to, it's awareness before dealing with the fear. So first, you have to open up their minds to what's coming and how fast or how quickly it will happen. And in many industries, sometimes the technology takes a while before it actually takes off. You know, we've been talking about electric cars forever. It's really this year, and it's really with Tesla, that suddenly everything accelerated. And it's the same thing with artificial intelligence, it's the same thing with robots or drones. We know it's coming, but sometimes it can take 10 years to come. So it's very hard for the CEO to make decisions too early, as hard as it is to make it too late. So first they have to understand what's the inflection point. The second thing is you have to bombard them with those new ideas and examples. And in the consulting world, the rule of change is 8 times, which means you have to hear it 8 times before you start realizing it's actually happening. So a lot of it is awareness. The first time you talk about replacing workers with robots, and a CEO, for example, if you're the CEO of Deloitte or KPMG today or a law firm, you kind of dismiss it. The second time you hear about it a little more, and so on. It's only around the 8 times that you're starting to think, one day, our contracts will not be reviewed by our lawyers anymore. There is no reason why a lawyer can be as good as a good algorithm to review what are the risks in the wording of a specific contract, especially when we're looking at antecedents. So it takes a while. The third thing is they listen to peers. So I find by allowing the spaces so those CEOs can actually be together and actually exchange on what's going on across industries is really important. So any event where you can get those to actually speak would really help them understand how far it's going.
A lot of our scientists and our researchers here are doing things that are impacting the world. So what they're doing is, it can change the world, but it is scary at the same time. And there's a lot of denialism that is out there when big change is coming. What can they do to help educate the public into realizing that AI is not dangerous, or it doesn't have to be dangerous, or self-driving cars are not going to kill you? There's always those scare movies that come out that attack the technology while we're still trying to advance it. What can they do to help change perception?
I think you have to lay out the consequences in human terms as well as technology terms. So part of it is vocabulary and articulating it. I think also you have to be very clear on what might be the risks so you can start dealing with them, and what are actually the positive consequences. And many of those technologies have huge implications for the good. You take drones, you know, once you have drones, yes, you can deliver a pizza or an Amazon package, but what's really important about drones is that you can get to remote areas, you can deliver vaccines in places that were not accessible previously, you can inspect mines, pipelines, and boats or trains remotely without sending workers to dangerous places. So unless you articulate the two facets of technology, I think it's going to be hard to convince people. And change is always a little scary, and it's scariest for those who have to change. I think it's very positive. If you go into the startup world right now, the world of fintech, what's happening in agriculture technology, is very, very exciting. And it might mean some jobs will be lost somewhere. So you have to explain people how to reinvent. And I think organizations like yours will find that part of your mission, I'm very sorry about that, part of your mission is also to continue educating. So it's not just a scientist you should educate, but as a society, how much are you doing to actually explain what the research is doing today and the positive implications?
Okay. There's that old saying with great power wields great responsibility. How does this affect science and technology and the work that our researchers and scientists are doing? How much of what their work is do they need to feel to take some responsibility for what happens to it afterwards?
There's two questions here. Is how big the responsibility is, and how do you deal with it as a scientist? I think there are huge responsibilities in terms of the decisions we have to make. Taking an autonomous car. You're driving a car and you might have an accident and kill the passengers of your car or kill the people crossing the street. Who's going to come up with a decision whether to decide the car to stop and save your passengers versus saving the people you're about to run over if you go against the obstacle? So all those decision making are going to be very important. There's also decision making on human bodies. We're talking about healthcare and improving health. We know disease eradication will eventually happen for most diseases, and we know we're going to age and actually live to be 120, 150. People talk about eternity. But if we an aging population, you know, what are the consequences of an aging population in terms of population growth, in terms of the types of housing we'll need to design for the population, in terms of retirement programs and being able, if people live 60, 70 years past retirement, how are we going to afford to do that? And I think these are the types of things that scientists need to think about before we start replacing organs and eyesight and hearing aids that are so performing that people will actually live longer and healthier. It's a good thing per se, but it has a cost on society. So unless you get the right players together to think through that, it won't happen. So the responsibility of scientists, is it up to them to bring those players together? I think partly so. If you are making people live until they're 150, you know, you need to talk to governments and to society to understand how we're going to save for retirement in that case. What is the social structure that will support that kind of society we'll have?
That's very interesting that every action that could be beneficial also might have a detriment at the same time unless the proper infrastructure is in place. It all is like a domino effect.
Yeah. I do a lot of work in Canada with Henry Mintzberg, and he talks about the balanced society, which is really those three players coming together. You've got the businesses, you've got the government, and you've got civil societies, NGOs. And it's really those three parties coming together on any scientific subject can really think together about what will it mean. If you take a technology, for example, like the human enhancement, again, you know, it has to be those three parties that think together about the implications. One only alone will not be enough.
It's amazing how quickly things are happening. Do you think that all these three parties can come together and make the right decisions? Because technology it's accelerating quickly.
We've had examples of that. We have examples of, if you take, for example, disease eradication, if you think about the role of the Gates Foundation, right, of getting someone from business and getting the right donors and getting a foundation to actually solve a world problem, you can really see how powerful it can be. And it can be very structured, it can be very, very professionally done, and it can be very, very efficient. So we had example what it happened. We have so few of them, though. So, you know, your students will have, if they have the appetite to play that role, I think there's a very optimistic future for them.
It sounds like what we really need is strong leaders.
Yes.
People who want to take the responsibility, make the change, and step forward and say, okay, let's talk about this.
Yeah, it's all about the people, right? It's all about the minds and the people. And I think you touched originally on which networks do we need to branch out to, what do we need to do? It's the toolkit that those leaders will have. That will be one of my conclusions later today, is you have to figure out what are the tools that are going to help you play that role. Do you know how to network? Do you know how to reach out to business or civil society? Can you raise funding? So if you've got a great patent, an invention, can you structure a company around it to put it elsewhere in the world? So I think, yes, we'll see a lot of that.
Okay. So it's not just about the idea and what they come up with in the lab, it's what they can do with it after and how they can market it and who they can network that will...
Yes.
Result and bring
yes.
them the results.
Yes, and I think, you know, you're saying leadership, management, project management, all those skills will be so powerful for a scientist as well. It's not just about the science. And that's why I'm saying get a second degree to help you combine it with your scientific mind so you can actually be efficient in change and be part of that disruption.
Okay. I know you mentioned that scientists should get a secondary degree in one of the humanities. How about CEOs? They always just focus on business. Should they get a degree in one of the sciences to understand technology differently?
That would be great. Try to get a CEO to spend time in stepping out of their role and retrain. I think they should. There's a big fashionable thing to say right now in North America, which is everybody should learn coding. I'm not sure that's the solution. I think understanding the principles of coding and how the ability to recognize patterns, to pick up the best patterns, put it together, and then go further is very useful. I would say every CEO should look at science, whether it's to get a degree or whether it's to get exposed to it, get immersed in it, get surrounded by people around you who understand science better, would be very, very important. We're seeing that today in boards, for example, where more and more board members coming into boards have a technical background. There might be CIOs, there might be chief technology officers, sometimes academics on the science network. And I think that will actually bring huge richness in the discussions around the table beyond a financial statement into what really is the differentiation we're bringing, how are we going to market it, where else can we take that technology?
Okay. We have a few minutes left. I'm going to take some questions from the audience. I see someone.
Hello, good morning. Just a question about the relationship between, you talk a lot about networking and is essential, but often in this environment we talk about networking and science. What about social networks and scientists? Because it looks like that are trying to avoid it. It's not very common to find a scientist that is using social network powerful, and in my opinion, be here and there in the same time could be a big chance for all of them. But maybe we have to break this kind of wall, because it looks like science is there and social networking is that. Actually, social networking is a mirror of reality, and maybe they have to take the chance to work on that. What's your opinion about it?
I'm a huge fan of social networking. I think we have at the tip of our fingers, as I explained, a huge opportunity to branch out. I'll give you one example. I've been following carefully what a very senior executive called Beth Comstock. She was the CMO of GE. She's now vice chair of GE. Very, very active on social networks. Everything she's tweeting or she's Instagramming is about science. Design, science, 3D, robotics, artificial intelligence. If I were a scientist and I've ever wanted to eventually understand how big companies will ever use my science, I would be connecting with Beth. And you know what? When you connect with her, she replies to you. So you can be a young scientist at COST today, exchanging with one of the most influencers in technology and science, in one of the most respected companies in the world. So that kind of thing is magical. And I think there should be no shyness in reaching out to those types of networks. And we have that ability today. And I'm working with senior executives. They are craving that kind of interaction with young people, especially those developing the science of the future. So I think that would work really, really well. You're bringing another interesting idea than what you're saying there's no social network for scientists. Well, maybe you should invent it. Maybe that could be something that CARS could be doing, is let's create it. I mean, there's always something about let's use the ones that exist, but maybe you need to create some sort of social networking for scientists around the world, around the subjects of interest. The tools are not complicated. It would be a great task for some of your young people who really want to get on with it. But again, if you do a social network for scientists, you'll put your own biases of talking only with scientists. I think you need to create a social network with scientists, anthropologists, philosophers, teachers, to actually create that ecosystem around science. Or you use one of the networks that exist. There are, I would actually argue, a lot of places where scientists exchange today on social networks. There are a number of Facebook groups today around future science and technologies, futuristic groups. You call them science fiction, but they're not, you know, science fiction is coming to our daily lives very quickly, that are very powerful. Interesting enough, around neuroscience, we found Google Plus, which is not used by anyone else anymore, was actually really good for scientists. There were at least 4 or 5 circles in Google Plus that were with 8,000 to 10,000 neuroscience people, professors, students exchanging on those subjects. And I see you look astonished. So you have to dig a little bit, all right? But it has been used, but as you said, maybe not enough, and maybe not as an ecosystem enough.
Just a second question then. What is the in just in one sentence, if you have to tell to a science to use social network, what you said at the first, what you say as the first sentence? If there's a social, there's a scientist and you want to convince them to use it, what is your first sentence?
Interesting. It's part of the puzzle, I would say. It's part of the puzzle. So you're a scientist, you're looking at facts. It's part of the facts and the puzzle for you to help solve what you want.
Okay, we have several from our online community. I'm going to combine them into one with a follow-up. First of all, who among us here needs to be worried that their jobs may be eliminated by machines? What kind of jobs are on their way out? And secondly, Are machines going to make us lazy if we depend increasingly on them? Are we going, as humankind, going to become lazier and lazier as time goes by?
Okay. Will jobs disappear? Yes. Which kinds of jobs? The data I've seen seems to say that it's not actually the lower level jobs that will disappear, it's the middle management jobs. So one myth we have, because if you have machines, you have to install them, you have to upgrade them, you have to maintain them, you have to replace pieces, so new jobs will be created. The other thing is, think about when machines came into our fields and agriculture modernized. We lost a lot of jobs in agriculture, but they went elsewhere to the next industries that were created because we had steam engine and because we had electricity coming in. I think the same will happen. We'll have a displacement of jobs. Some jobs will disappear forever. You know, I believe in 10 years we will not have as many lawyers. A lot of services jobs will disappear. We won't have bankers. I think banks as we know them will be completely different. We already see branches closing off. Online banking is picking up. You know, universities and schools. I would love to see disruption in education. You know how hard it is to move an academic organization. It makes no sense today to see amphitheaters in Europe, for example, in universities with 2,000 students where they can barely see the teacher at the end of the room. There are a lot of better ways to learn. But as we have those schools disappearing, there will be a lot of people creating the curriculum and the programs and providing those courses online as well. Whether we will, what will we do when our jobs is replaced by machines is a good question. And it's a larger one. We have a lot of discussions right now on providing, for example, a basic income to everyone. Well, we'll have lots of vacation time. And I think it's something we really need to think about. Because if you are, I was watching coming in, there's a series called Humans, which I advise you to look at. It's like Black Mirror, one of those series that are very, very good at looking at the consequences of science. And in that series, there's a 13-year-old girl who's saying, why would I go and study at school? The machines will do most of the work anyway. What's my purpose? And I think it's something we need to think about very, very strongly. I think replacing the job of someone who picks up boxes in a warehouse, I'm not too worried about that. Replacing the job of people who go and inspect the ballasts of shipyards or people who fix electric lines, I'm not too worried about that. I'm more worried about people not knowing why they're studying for. And that's something I think as a society we need to think about very strongly.
I'd like to follow up on that. You've just described a number of fields in which machine intelligence will increasingly replace human intelligence. Still, behind the machine intelligence, you have algorithms which are created by human beings. The power that the creators of these algorithms have is pretty immense, and yet they're largely unknown, ungoverned, not transparent at all. Is there an awareness among the programming community and the creators of the algorithms of the power that they hold? And is there a need for any sort of code of conduct or increased transparency about this?
There's a huge awareness of that. And in fact, if anything history has taught us, when we see now the history, we haven't talked about it, of cybersecurity, potential hacking into, you're doing a lot of work with Internet of Things and potential hacking into those machines, those autonomous cars. It's a huge concern. What I can see from the technology community right now, they are trying to think about, can we create a scientific or algorithm systems that is more more secure, where we can trust it. You know, in a way, if you think about blockchain technologies, that's really what it's about. Is can we rethink what the purpose of the internet was originally, to create actually a safe place where we can have transactions, authentify where they're coming from, where specific orders are coming from. sadly, regulators are way behind. If you already think on data and data privacy, the ability to use private data for those rules that are governing those algorithms, the governments and the regulators are way behind that. By the time you understand the technology, it can be 2-3 years. The process is just too complicated. Will the industry self-regulate? I don't know. I think there's a lot of great people trying to do the right thing. But as everything, there's a counter trend. There's also a lot of people who will try to test all the limits of that new technology.
What about the types of algorithms, though, that require implicit assumptions about human behavior and human beings? For instance, who will get a mortgage? Who will get accepted into a university? What types of prisoners will be released early and what type will be held later? You know, this kind of thing. What kind of ads you'll be targeted by? This, you know, which really affect everyone kind of on a day-to-day basis in a low-key manner and sometimes in a very life-changing sort of manner.
And it can be both low-key and life-changing. I was talking to the CEO of an insurance company who said, we already know we have to stop insuring a car, but we have to insure the driver because we share the economy. Really what you're insuring is a driver. But he's saying, we've noticed that what we're starting doing now is we're changing the premium of insurance. If we have a client who just got separated or divorced, his premium eventually will be going up. Why? Because we know that when you're getting separated, within 6 months after that separation, you're stressed, you don't sleep very well, and the probability of you having an accident increases by 50%. Therefore, we are now logging to your Facebook status, and if you're going from in couple to separated, your insurance premium is coming up. Very simple. And actuaries in insurance companies will have measured that, and it's a very good business decision. But how do you deal with that and explain that to someone? And I think we'll have those rules all the time. My car, you know, does it change if they're about to run over? Do you change a decision if you're running over? Is it a kid? Is it an offender, a criminal offender? Does that change your decision? I think it does. And same thing with we're talking about life, you know, living longer. Is that open to everyone, or is that open just to the richest? How do you deal with that? And our health society today is structured around some people get better care than others. So we'll have to think about it.
Okay. We are out of time. This was a fascinating discussion, and I'm sure there was a lot more questions that people had to ask. Estelle will be our keynote tonight at 5:30 in the auditorium. So if you want to hear more about industry disruption, come by and listen to her talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.